G'day again. Well, this is our next video in some of the stuff that we're doing in our off-season in the way of some technical videos about how we set up our long-range rifles. I'd once again like to point out that we're not professionals, we're not trained, this is simply how we do things. A fair bit of thought that I put into setting up rifles and our long-range shooting that I would like to share as to what we do. But, like I said, I'm stressing it's our stuff, how I've worked out for our shooting, so I don't want to imply this is the right way, I'm just putting forward of what we do. Anyway, we'll set some rifles up over there on that log so you can see the rifles, and I'll go through with some of our rifle setup. Okay, so I've got a summer rifle setup here, which shows a bit of some choices to show the same sort of philosophies done on different platforms. A couple of things I'd like to start with. I'm going to put my glasses on. It's a bit bright. I don't like squinting, so I'll just excuse the glasses. What I want to go through to start off with is I get lots of questions here about Australia's gun laws and what we're allowed to have and not allowed to have over here. I won't get too complicated. I'm only going to be talking about the long-range firearms, but essentially, well, high-power firearms, I should say. What we're allowed over here is firearms for a job. Really, our job is not long-range shooting. The job or the purpose that you can get high-power firearms in Australia for most commonly is hunting. And on that score, if you're hunting different things at different ranges, it calls for different calibers are more suitable than other calibers, and that's the reason you can get different calibers. It also means that you can't get lots of the same caliber. You can't get three different 338s or three different 308s without having a real reason for all that sort of stuff. So that's the basics of it. Yes, we're allowed to have them. They've got to be licensed for a particular reason, and you're only allowed X amount of them. But other than that, yes, we can get a reasonable range of firearms. So the next thing that would bring me into is essentially with choosing a firearm for long range shooting, you can essentially, it's not quite you don't need to buy a 338 to shoot 1500 yards. A lot of people ask that sort of question as to, I want to get a 338 or I want to get a 50 cal or whatever it is. I get questions from the other side of the world. The truth of it is, you want a big gun for sure, go and get the big gun. But if it's a case of you want to really do long range shooting to a particular range, then it matters with what range you're shooting with. How you're shooting, what sort of shooting you're doing. The bigger calibers, the bigger magnums and things are a lot easier to shoot with muzzle brakes on because of the impact that they provide, because of the amount of percussion that they give. But at a lot of ranges, at the average 600 and 800 yard range, which a lot of people have the choice of using, or the only choice of using, you'll find you're not allowed to run a muzzle brake. They don't want a muzzle brake running alongside people. They blast the people alongside them more than the shooter. So it really is work out your caliber to what you want, and that's also on the cost side of things. The likes of shooting with a 308, which shoots really well out to 1500 yards, we've got videos to show that sort of stuff, or even a 223 out to that stuff. If you have the right barrel twist and the right ammunition, you can shoot accurately out to 1500 yards. A lot cheaper to the run than a 338 or a Remington Ultramag or the big guns. But like I said, I've got nothing against people wanting to buy a bigger gun because they want the bigger gun. It just is makes sense of what your purpose is. Okay, that all being said, I'll go through some of these firearms. Now up the front here, we've got our 308. This was my second high power firearm that I bought. It started off as just a SVF or the stainless steel fluted Remington 700 in a normal plastic stock that they come with. I went through a couple of different stocks. This is where I've ended up, and what I've actually done, what I bought it for, and the whole design of the process is that it's the heavy barrel. This is fluted to make it a little lighter. If I'd known more now, I probably wouldn't have bought fluted, but really it's fine for the 308. I've mounted it in a Bell & Carlson stock. The logic to the Bell & Carlson stock is it's a nice strong stock. It gives me good adjustability in the fashion of the length of pull and the cheek rest, so that works nicely. It's a nice looking stock. I've then modified it for things that I like to do. I've obviously got in a different bottom metal and in a magazine. So I've actually modified that to suit what I wanted to. That's nothing more aesthetics. And with the likes of those rifles, I like to be able to, with some of the stuff we do, to be able to action through 10 rounds is what I want to do on that side of things. And to get it to be able to hold the extension of the bullet, I'm generally messing with magazines. Or it's something you should check out with the fact the long range stuff, you're going to run a longer overall length on your bullet, so you want to make sure that cycles properly. The stock being nice and strong with an aluminium bed, we always glass bed as well to make sure that they're located as thoroughly and consistently as possible. All our rifles obviously are fully floated in the way of the barrel is not touching anywhere. A feature that I like, as this one here, I've cut the stock off and made my own bipod. So it's essentially a fairly cheap version of a Harris bipod. It isn't Harris, but it's similar to. And I've used this simply because I wanted to do something custom and try it. It's worked. I probably will go through and upgrade it and make it better later on. It's another thing I'll mess with. I like to do that sort of stuff. But the design here is to get a fairly low center of gravity by having the actual pivot point and the actual bipod hinging point very high up. So I've cut the stock off, and there's another couple of things I'll go into there. What I'm actually doing, by putting your bipod back further, you get more ability to raise your barrel with less amount of movement here, simply because of your fulcrum point over from the rear of your bag to the front is shorter. So essentially that lets you, with less adjustment here, get more raising out of the barrel. The other feature of having your legs tucked away up high is that essentially your legs are always, or as a rule, going to be no more than double their height at their full extension. So that means in something like this, although it's down pretty close to level with the setup, the legs are, like I said before, I like to set up the rifle fairly tall. Although these legs are reasonably short, you'll notice that when I actually extend these legs, because they are long, I can have an enormous amount of elevation because I've got this extra stuff that's hidden up inside here. So for me, that works really nicely. It's a way that I've set it up to make it work. Like I said, this is one of the earlier modifications, and I like the way that worked for those reasons. And I haven't found any negatives to it. I'll just lower all that back down. Okay, so it's back down there. Also not needed at all. I tend to like the larger knob. It's just nicer to cycle, nicer to function. It's something, these are with the 700s. And it's another feature I'd say in buying a rifle. There's obviously lots of exotic guns out there. There's lots of choices. The 700 is a bit of a favorite. And one of the reasons for that, not only is a good action, it works really well and all that sort of caper. The other feature is that you can buy lots of parts for this. Buying rails and adjustable rails, buying the likes of this is just a bolt-on knob to give you where it actually just screws on there. It's nice and simple to do that sort of process. I like that feature. The stocks you can buy from, the bottom metals you can buy from, there's lots of stuff you can buy from. Obviously, there's lots of other rifles that are the same, but it's one of the better ones out of that choice. The other piece, which is on the bottom of this one, which I put on the bottom of all of them, is the bag slide I put on there. This is an early design. It was designed with aesthetics in mind. It's a stainless steel barrel, so I made that of aluminium. It's not quite as functional as my later ones. It still works well and does its job. It's not perfectly in line with the barrel, but it's pretty similar in the way of its angle. And of course the 308, it doesn't have a lot of hit in it, doesn't hit back very hard, but that functions very well as a very precise unit to shoot with. We've shot this out to 2,000 yards, but it's a very good shooter in the 1,000 to 1,500 yards where it's very comfortable. Okay, we'll move down to another one. This is a little bit the opposite end of the pile. This is the SAKO TRG42, so this is the 338. On this, you'll see a lot of the same design characteristics. It is a fairly heavy gun, but because it's a 338, I've gone for extra weight. I've actually put extra weight into it. I've actually done recently with this one, the latest lot of modifications, which I haven't shot it like this yet, But essentially what I found in this rifle, I should start with what I've done to this rifle basically already. There, this is the TRG bipod on the TRG, and as you can see, we get some questions, is it mounted to the barrel? No, it's not. It's mounted to the stock, very high up in the stock. These rifles are a little peculiar. They have an aluminium chassis, and then they have a forestock and a rear stock that bolt to that chassis. But this actually bolts to the chassis, so there's clearance underneath the rifle, not underneath the barrel, not a lot, but there's clearance in it. Once again, because it's all tucked away, it gives us a lot of adjustment out of this bipod. I like this bipod. It has claws and slides on the bottom of the feet. It works really nicely out there in the dirt. Not so cool for using on a table, but I don't shoot off a table. This one here, these pieces in the front here, are actually some weight. In going through all the process of trying to make this shoot nicely, and don't get me wrong, it had a good group, but in the way of making it getting better, I went through the process of what do I have to do to get this to jump as little once it's, once we've fired it, to make it as stable and move as little as possible. You notice my muzzle brake up the front, and as you go through this, you'll notice there's muzzle brakes on all the rifles. There's two reasons. For this reason is very much about making this gun shoot nicely. This actually has some up angle on the flutes, which means that essentially it actually pushes the gas up a little bit, which gives you a little bit of downforce on the rifle. But a big feature out of we shoot in the dirt is where we're prone shooting in the summertime, there's a lot of dirt and dust and rocks and gravel and leaves and things that get blown around the place. So we deliberately, all the brakes, so we even run them on the likes of the 223, which has got nothing to do with trying to stop them from pushing, it's got all to do with stopping them throwing dirt around. We've got nice scopes, we've got essentially nice guns, we don't want them full of dirt, we don't want crap in our hair, we don't want to have a mess from shooting. So having that deflecting the exhaust from, or the blast from the muzzle, works really nicely. This one here, I'll point out, I found with this custom brake I designed, I got a lot of percussion. This would actually make your sinuses hurt when I first put this brake on. I then built these little percussion, or these little shields, that stop that percussion from smacking you so hard in the face, which means that it's just a very nice gun to shoot. If we go back down the rifle, we've obviously got on this one the cold shot base, which essentially gives me a lot more elevation, or I can take this thing up over 300 MOA of adjustment if I want to, with a 120 MOA scope, and ignore the 150 down here, it's a 300 MOA cold shot base. That gives me a lot of adjustment. I get a fair few questions about these. I think they're a good product. I've found that the way I wanted to use it, it wasn't quite as precise as I wanted it to be. I did a lot of modifying to it, rebushed it, relocked it. I use it in a locked up form when I shoot with it. If I want to make an adjustment, there's a few spanners involved to make that happen. So I do that before I go out for the shoot, but it gives me the ability to make the very long shots with it. All my rifles, I run some form or other. I quite like these are US optics in the way of a cant bubble, so I can see the cant of my rifle. Very important in long range shooting. I like these. They're down easily in your eye line. You're not having to look up over your scope to find them or anything. They work nicely, and a very nice feature, they tuck away and they're really no problems with going in the gun box. This rifle, it is a fairly high quality rifle. I didn't have to mess with triggers. I've just fine tuned them, which is something I should touch on. I like to shoot at somewhere around 1 to 1.25 pounds. I want that to shoot very nicely and evenly. I tend to be, we're not trying to do rapid fire or push things where we want a firmer trigger to lean on. So around the 1 to 1.25 pounds, no more than 1.5 pounds, really no less than 0.75 pound, depending on how the trigger feels, what it breaks like. But this one here is set up at just a 1.1 pounds is where I actually have this trigger set up. This one already comes with a larger knob, so it cycles very nicely. They are a very nice gun to cycle and do what you want to do with on this TRG. A feature that is different and no one would have seen before, because I've only just done it, is I've changed my rear stock. Now, what I found on this rifle, being a bigger rifle, being a bigger caliber to make it shoot nicely, I will always go with more weight, and I should touch on that in general. I, in the long range rifles, even the 223, is coming in at just over 13.5 pounds. This one here is nearly 22 pounds, is what it actually weighs. I find that's a nicer way to shoot. It's a little easier on me, but the big detail is how much the rifle deals with the percussion, how it deals with its harmonics. It makes it easier for everything to behave with the rifle being heavier. It's not something that's trying to lug around the place and take to on our backs for a 4 mile hike or anything. So the extra weight on that score helps us. This actually has some extra weight. They have quite a lightweight. There's an aluminium frame inside these stocks, but I found it was still very lightweight. I've actually put some extra weight inside here. Now I've gone to my final, where I think I'm at my final modification with it. I fitted a proper. This is heavy hollow bar down the bottom here, so it's got a bit of weight to it, but it's a very nice slide down the bottom of the rifle. It's very thoroughly attached to that stock. It did have an adjustable base I built in here, but now I have my base that I use that has the adjustment in it, or my bag base that I use. I don't need any adjustment in it, so that's basically all solid. One feature I did notice of this when I did some studying on my footage, I found the gun was doing a funny little bounce after it was fired. Wasn't really causing me any accuracy issues, but as one of the things I want to get right, I wanted to make that go away. When I analysed things, I actually found I was getting a tiny bit of flex through this shape here, because when it was hitting hard here, it was actually, once it put a fair bit of pressure on me, it was actually getting a tiny bit of a flex in this part of the rifle. Now I run heavy loads, and I set up the gun to apply that pressure properly to my shoulder, and I found on the heavier, and on the chassis guns and on the heavier stocks, I wasn't having that problem. So I've designed this piece in here. It actually clamps here and butts hard up against this part, so the butt pad pushes straight to it, and then I have this pushing at the base of the aluminium chassis. So essentially, I've turned this into a full chassis gun, where it transfers that load straight down to my shoulder, and should, in theory, stop any of the issues that I'm seeing in the way of the gun bouncing. Don't get me, it wasn't bad. It would come back to within a couple of MOA each time we shot, but being the sort of guy I am, I definitely have set it up to make it to try and get it as close to perfect as I can. You'll also notice with this one, my custom cheek rest. That is essentially, I've made it out of a rubber composite, trying to make it as light as I can, more dealing with a gun that was kicking hard, but you'll also notice the shapes on things. You definitely want this, you obviously want it up where it's in the right place so you can actually rest your face on it and look through your scope. But I also found that you don't want it to be, I've set this up so essentially as the goes back, the cheek rest runs away from your face. So you're not getting whacked in the face by it all, it'll actually come away. Obviously depends on how your gun behaves, what that stuff's made out of, but it is a place that you can do some messing with. Before we go on to scopes and the setup on that scope, we'll go to exactly the same process in a chassis gun. Now this is just a 243 Howa. This is my first ever high power rifle I bought several years ago. The first one I bought for myself. And this one has been through, it had a Black Hawk Axion stock on it, which is how it came from the dealer to us. And it worked very well. It was very nice. It was very nice and consistent. I had put some stiffening and strengthening into it to make it shoot well. But those stocks do something that I wouldn't recommend for long range shooting. They have down the back of them, the Axion, has a recoil device that lets the spring absorb the pressure onto your shoulder. Not really needed for a 243, but it still made the gun lighter to shoot. But what I found with this rifle is it would be so consistent some days and inconsistent on other days. What my decision was, that essentially it was a gun that you had to hold in exactly the right way. Because once it started to use those springs, if you were holding it differently, it started to give you a different point of impact. So I've changed over to a chassis rifle, which makes it nice and strong, nice and solid. And then you'll notice all the similar features are there. I have a fairly, because it's nice and close, I have a fairly high point that my bipod shoots swings from. It's a Harris bipod, I love them. They're nice and simple, they work really well. Having your lock in the way of the S lever, that they call, to be able to swing the gun and lock that, super important to make it nice and consistent, you don't have to mess with it. This is another one that this is a Hinterland Shooting Supplies muzzle brake, works well. not really needed for a 243, but with its floor plate in it, that the design of the floor plate, the gases are more going up, we get that nice protection from the dirt and the gunk. It is a heavy barrel, which is 100% I would recommend for long range shooting. Just absorb the vibrations. The harmonics are a lot more stable. They work very nicely on that score. The pistol grip, you know, that's something that is neither here nor there as to whether it's better than the other style of long range rifles or target rifles or not. What I will say is that essentially it does follow the same thing. The hand grip of, and I'll get you to look over here. Coming in the other side. I find from a normal stock, which works very well as a shooter, but my hand is more up like this. So in the prone position, I've got more twist on my wrist. So I prefer the type of stock where I can come down in the pistol grip sort of style, or in this target style rifle, where essentially my hand is then down more, so my wrist is straighter, and it's just a more relaxed grip. It's something that is simply a comfort thing, and as I've been through in other videos, it's one of the things that I find is an important part of long range shooting, making yourself comfortable. Come back over to this fella. The only modification done with this one is for the bag base. So I have the nice slide, and I've made a new piece down the bottom here, which gives me a nice slide down the bottom of the rifle. But these are great. They're very nice to shoot with. It's got a nice soft recoil pad. It's actually got a bit of softening to do the same thing in the way of protecting your cheek. And this rifle is also set up with the US Optics cant lever. And we've done a little modification. These are quite a nice modification, more as a tactical thing, being able to remove the scope bolts with the bottom of the bolt. But just really a nicety, not needed at all in that score. Now I'll touch on the scope. As you'll notice on all these rifles, the scope is reasonably high. It's not really high, but up at the base here, we're reasonably high. I used to, like everyone, focus on getting the scope down low, because I don't know if I was told or if it's more the thought of it, the closer your scope is to your bore, the less adjustment you're going to require. The truth of it is, over 100 yards, that's completely incorrect. Over 100 yards, your bullet has already dropped, and I haven't done the maths past 4 inches, but if you have a scope set up at 1.5 inches versus a scope set up at 3.5 inches, and when I'm talking about that, that's the measurement from your bore access to your scope line, the center of your scope. That measurement there, if you have it set up at 1.5 inches, you have more adjustment at 200 yards and at 300 yards and at 500 yards and at 1,000 yards even, than if you have the scope set up at 3.5 inches. Now, I can draw pictures and explain that in the maths of it, but what I would really say, rather than getting complicated about it, is that essentially jamming your scope down, struggling with getting the right base to get it as low as you can. This looks a bit closer because it has this extra shield around the barrel, but it is not necessary. The place where I focus on the important things that I want to make my scope do, I want to be able to get, essentially, as I've been through before, if I have 120 minutes of adjustment in my scope, that means I want approximately a 60 minute base combination. This is a 40 minute rail with a 20 minute uni mount for the scope, so I end up with 60 minutes of adjustment in my, or 60 minutes of angle in my base, and that means I'm tilting the front of my rifle down, or my front of my scope down, and that means I need to have a reasonable amount of height in my scope. It's not a negative thing at all. You set up your cheek well to suit. As I've described before, I like to hold the whole gun and everything, set it up high. It makes it so my head is more relaxed. I can have a straighter neck, a more comfortable neck in my shooting position, and I essentially get my eye into the right place with everything being a little bit higher. But the main bit I wanted to point out with that, the trying to get it low, if you go and have a look at the 338 over there, is see how high that scope is. It doesn't need to be high. I'm not saying it needs to be high, but what I would suggest is that essentially you set up the scope to suit your body is the most important thing. The thought of trying to keep it lower isn't relevant for any good reason that I know of. There's people will tell you I think it's the point blank range, or essentially where you can shoot up to 100 yards. You've obviously got to allow for it. If you've got a 4-inch high scope and you're shooting at 25 yards, you're going to shoot 3 inches low. So up to 100 yards, there is an issue. There is something to allow for. But that's not what you use a high power rifle for. And it's certainly not like what you use a long range shooter for. Our shooting is done, 200 yards is close range for us. Essentially 1,000 yards is where we start. And out at 1,000 yards, there's not a lot of difference. In fact, like I said, a 3.5-inch high scope versus a 1.5-inch high scope, you'll find there's a tiny bit more adjustment for the 1.5. Anyway, that's enough on that side of things there. The basics as an overview as to what we set up in the way of a rifle. I like essentially to set up with some form of slide on the bottom there. And I like to generally put a little bit of height in there. I'm not trying to tuck it away, because I do want my chest off the ground and I want it to meet up to my shoulder where everything is a little bit more comfortable. I'm setting up the rear buttstock essentially is set up to the right point to try and get in line with the force from the rifle. I don't want it too high, I don't want it too low. So essentially, as much as possible, all of the design of the stock and the muzzle brake and the weight I put in the rifle is trying to make that rifle behave very well when it's fired. I want the stock and the stock versus the rifle versus the impact to work well together. As I said, in this case, I've made modifications to make this work well. If we go over to the likes of a Bell & Carlson stock, they're very nice, strong stock. They are reasonably heavy. In my mind, for what we do, that's a good feature. That's something I want. And then it's custom designing to what suits. I suppose the other thing, and this is very much my way of doing things, nothing's ever perfect. Things need modifying. I didn't really like the very hard butt pad that came with them. Some people might like that. I go through and find a butt pad that works like I wanted to for that rifle. It's about comfort for me. If you have something that's just giving you a little bit of a sting when you shoot it, you'll start to flinch. It'll start to cause you issues. So if it's not right, adjust it. And that might be you, or it might be the rifle. But once again, the rear slide is something that I work and I found much more comfortable to shoot with. It's certainly, we have our adjustable bag base, which is something that makes it easier still, but just being able to have that on the bag and make it function properly on the bag is very important. You're setting up your scope, setting up your cheek rest to the right place, getting comfortable in your hand, your rifle. We can go through that, but I'm sure there's lots on YouTube that will show you how to actually set up this to the right height. And then scope wise, this one here is a rifle that I will do more with. This is set up quite low, and this is from the early days of me going through and working it out. Actually, it's something which is in the drawing board for this one here. I'm going to go through and make this a bit nicer. It's a bit rough on the front there. It works really well, but I'm going to make that a little bit nicer. I like the way the gun functions otherwise, but I'm also going to raise this around about 1/4 inch to get a more comfortable head position for me. But the overall, same deal, reasonably heavy barrel. Obviously, another feature I touch on there is that if you are going into buying your first high power rifle and you want to go for long range shooting, your barrel twist is something you have to get into. Barrel length and barrel twist. Barrel length not as important, but really in the likes of a 223, 24 inches is probably ideal. In the likes of a 308, 25, 26 inches, that's what this is, 26 inches is what I would call ideal, although there's nothing wrong with 24 inches. In the likes of the bigger ones, the 300, or the 300 Win Mag, the Remington Magnum, the likes of the larger rifles, or even this 338, then really 26 inches is the minimum. This is actually 27, and a quarter, or 27 and 3/8 is the length of this barrel. Obviously going longer can give you some slight benefits. You have to be careful with going too long. You can reach a point of diminishing losses, which means that essentially what you're gaining out of more time for the powder to push harder to try and get more speed runs into where you're starting to create more friction, and you're starting to get to a point where you're going backwards. And that's a point I'll touch on in general on that score, is that more velocity is not necessarily more accuracy, and doesn't necessarily help you at all with long range shooting. In the theory of just doing it to make it faster, to make it go better, I understand it. I'm a bit of a horsepower junkie myself, I get the process. But in practice, shooting, you want the thing to be comfortable and you want it to be consistent. The way we deal with the long range stuff, as we've done with this one here, is go for more MOA. If the bullet isn't quite going as fast to get to the same place, you simply need to adjust more on your scope. And that's the last bit I'll touch on that. I think we've been across that fairly comprehensive fashion. Your scope and the scope you choose is a huge important part of this. You don't need to spend $2,000 to $4,000, don't get me wrong. But you will find the more you can spend, as long as you're smart about doing it, the nicer it is to shoot. The more light conditions you can deal with, and the nicer it is to shoot. I really started the proper long range shooting with the Citron scopes, which are very well priced scope for what they are, and I certainly like them in their price point, but there's features that I could see I could make better with basically going for slightly better scopes. But it is not the be-all and end-all. This is the beast, and essentially this lucky rifle got that scope because I wanted to upgrade the scope on the 243 over here, and I really chose to put the Attacker, which I think is a great scope, onto it, and this one got a better scope because I can. In reality, probably don't need it, but there is a huge range of scope in there, but certainly don't skimp. The truth of it is that the old saying that essentially there's no point putting a $500 scope on a $3,000 rifle because all you've got is a $500 rifle. Well, I agree with that to a degree. There is a level of spending money to make. You need to spend a certain amount to get a reasonable shooting, but don't do the other way applies as well, which means you put a $5,000 scope on a $500 rifle, you've still got a $500 rifle. The systems have to mate, and they'll only shoot as well as the worst part. One thing I should put into that, I've mentioned on all the rifles how we've got we use our adjustable bag base. For people who know our channel would know about it, to make it so it does make sense to the people who don't, this is one of our adjustable bag bases. This is our latest version of it, which has some extra little feet on the rear of it. But essentially, this is the system of where we run the rear of the stock. So I'll just set that up so that becomes a little more obvious. We'll use the good old 308. Bring these up to where they actually make a bit of sense. Like I said, I like to shoot with a fairly high setup rifle. But what I actually have designed this for, essentially, it holds the bag nicely. It's nice and stable. The real feature is that when it comes to adjusting, these work very nice in the way of, rather than the normal process of squishing your bag to raise and lift it, you can actually get your bag set in there nice and neat and tidy, and then so it's all nice and repeatable, and when you're shooting it's all moving in there nicely. This obviously is not normally sitting on a wobbly piece of wood, it'll be sitting down the ground. But you'll see, to actually adjust, I can actually just tweak this one way or the other way, and we're getting a nice bit of raising and lowering. I found with when you do long range stuff and extreme stuff, you can spend a while figuring things out, where your impacts are landing, where you practice stuff, you go through rounds. What you find to start off with, it's quite easy just to squish and hold and get your bag settled. But you find it keeps moving and it'll settle in, and you've got to reset everything. On this, it can settle in, you can lose half an inch
you can simply tweak this thing. You tweak it, move it around, you want to wriggle again, you can really find, you can actually get to the point of there is no stress. You're not squishing a bag, you're not pushing anything, just a little tweak on this and you can make quarter, half MOA adjustments as simple as a turn of a dial. A farmer hand sits over the top of it very easily, but I found for me and for my little partner, Sam, shooting, something that she found was really changed her shooting quite a bit, but it's what I designed. This thing is the slide, is so the gun will cycle through there nice and straight. The bag base and its adjustment is simply to make it easier. It's not going to make you more accurate. It's no different than shooting on a bag. It just makes it easier for repeatability to be able to just simply adjust this. And as I've said countless times now, when it comes to comfort, you want less stress in your body. You don't be pushing on things. You don't be squeezing on the bag. And it's one of the things that can get frustrating. This just helps remove some of that frustration. Anyway, that's just that piece there, and I just wanted to make sense for the people who are seeing us for the first time of what I'm talking about when I talk our bag base at the rear of the gun. Okay, so I just want to do an overview there, so I've got it all. I've done a fair bit of talking there, and I get a little bit lost sometimes with that sort of stuff. What I'd go through is a basic setup on our rifles. I want a heavy barrel suited with the right twist to suit the heavier long-range projectiles that we shoot. I want it solidly bedded to its stock in some form or other. I want the stock to be strong and be able to deal with the percussion from the rifle as thoroughly and consistently as possible. I always run a slide to go through the bag on the bottom there for, once again, consistent as possible. I set up my scope on, essentially, as I said, a base that is approximately half the total adjustment in my scope. I don't know if I mentioned why that was, and that is so I can get the maximum adjustment on my scope. And as I've been asked countless times, if I put my rifle on a 40 MOA base, will I still be able to zero at 100 yards? If you have a 100 or minutes of elevation in your scope, then approximately, I say approximately because it's not always exactly the same, but your scope is going to be able to zero at 100 yards with approximately a 50, half that MOA, so a 50 MOA base. These are 120 MOA base, so I can set it up with a 60 minute base. And I will zero at 100. I always zero at 100. It is, in my mind, foolish to zero anywhere else. It is the range where you're going to get the most consistent starting point for different weather variables and different ammunition you want to run in it. And once you're out at any further than I think there's people who will zero at 800 yards trying to get more range out of it. The truth of it is, once you're out at long range shooting, that 2 or 3 minutes you've saved is worth nothing in the big picture. So zeroing at 100 yards or 100 meters, if you're metric and that's what you do, is 100% the place to zero from. I always run a good and accurate setup in the way of a cant system, so I can actually check my cant. Very important at what you're doing there. I always make sure that I use a small amount of a locking compound, and don't over-tension your bases and rings, but they will shake free if you don't use them properly. And you make sure in the higher power stuff, in some cases you need to drill that stuff out and re-tap it into larger threads, depending on your rifle, the type of stuff that is individual. Cheek rest, strength of stock, where you put your stock, all very important for consistent shooting. Muzzle brake is something that we use for the prone position, and I would suggest for accurate long range shooting is really a thing that will provide consistency and is a nice thing to use for the extreme range stuff. As on this one, putting weight into a rifle is not something I'm shy of. I don't mind it being a little heavier. It isn't a be all and end all by any means, and the better you get your rifle shooting, the less weight you can run it with. But the truth of it is, unless you're planning on a shit hits the fan situation and you're trying to haul this thing for 20 miles on your back, If it is the sort of shooting we're doing, where you're going to cart it out to it in the truck and then you're going to do your shooting, then a bit of extra weight just makes it a nicer piece of gear to shoot. So that's basically an overall on our rifles, and I hope that was of some value or at least some interest to some people. I'll stress again, this is simply what I do for my guns, what I do for Sam's guns, but it's something that I we've found a lot of success with, and I hope there's some value for you. Thank you for checking us out.